That's Gavin.
Am I jumping or is that okay?
It's okay.
It's okay. Okay, here we go. Hi guys, welcome to another podcast. In this podcast, we're going to be discussing confidence and self-belief. I've got two fantastic athletes here with me from the athlete mental team at the Dame Kelly Holmes Trust. They're going to introduce themselves. But for those people that don't know, my name's Adam Whitehead. My sport was swimming. Swam for Great Britain for 10 years and won the Commonwealth Games and the European Championships in that time. And also swam pretty badly at the Olympic Games. But there you go. That's another story. Yona, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, sure thing. My name is Yona Knight-Wisdom. I'm a diver. I represent Jamaica, competing internationally. I've done two Olympics in 2016 and 2020, or 2021. I don't really know which one to call it. But I've also won a silver medal at the World Cup and at the Pan American Games. And I've just completed 10 years competing internationally. So here's to another 10. Probably not. That's a bit too much.
Yeah, because you're still going, aren't you? You're still very much in the thick of it and looking forward to, is it Paris next?
Yeah, I'm still going. I just competed this weekend at the British Nationals. I've got a lot of competitions coming up this summer, the World Championships and the Commonwealth Games. Wow. Eyes on Paris 2024, which is now only 2 years away. You know, it feels like it's not far away at all. So working hard to get ready to try and qualify for that and then see how I do if I get there.
Amazing. Well, thanks for joining us, Yona. And Jenny,
Times, it makes you realise how busy you used to be with all the travelling and the competing.
Yeah.
But Jen, you're equally as busy now, aren't you, with different priorities, though, I guess.
Yeah, very different now. The two children keeping me very busy. So my name's Jenny Wallwork. I'm a former Great Britain badminton player. I've been lucky enough to travel all over the world, competing in a sport that I've loved for many years, and picked up some Commonwealth medals and European medals along the way. And I'm an athlete mentor for the Dame Kelly Holmes Trust, which I've been doing for, I think, 8 years now, which is crazy, and I absolutely love it.
Fantastic. I think what would be really interesting to kick things off with, I think when people look in at sport and they look at sports people, they often feel like they are extremely confident people, but you know, in our roles and as athletes, but then you know, meeting other athletes, I think the thing that I've noticed a lot with people is actually sometimes they're not as confident as what you know people might perceive them. So Yona, for you, obviously you're still competing now. What does confidence mean to you? What, you know, if you had to sort of define it in some way, what does it mean?
I define confidence as just having trust in yourself and trust in your ability and being able to do what you do without any doubt. And confidence is one of the hardest things to find, but the easiest thing to lose. It doesn't take a lot for you to lose confidence, but it takes a long time for you to build confidence. And I guess over the last kind of 5-6 years since Rio 2016, really, I've been on the process of rebuilding confidence, and I've now got to a stage where I'm comfortable in saying that I'm very confident with my diving at the moment, and it's taken a long time to get there. And it's hard to say exactly what I've done and exactly what has caused the change for the confidence to return. But it's almost scary to actually say it openly, say that I'm feeling confident in myself, because I don't want to jinx it. I don't want to lose it because of how easily it can go. So it's a very fragile feeling, and you just got to enjoy it whilst it lasts.
So yeah. Now, what happened? You mentioned Rio. Then, what happened in Rio or after Rio that you had that sort of dip in confidence?
Well, Rio for me was a dream since the age of 9, and it was basically my life goal. And I got there, and I thoroughly enjoyed my time at the Olympics, and I was happy with my performance, even though I wanted more. But then I came back after the competition, flew home, and I'd also graduated uni at that same time, and I had like nothing to do. And I felt like life would be super different after I became an Olympian, but it didn't really change as much as I anticipated. And that surprised me. Going forward into the next year competitively, I added a few dives to my list and changed a few things, made it a little bit more difficult, and I wasn't competing as well as I had done previously. And at that point, I was starting to question whether I still had what it takes to be a good diver, whether I'd be able to figure out these dives, whether I'd be able to compete well, whether I'd be able to achieve the goal of reaching the next Olympics, even though it was so far away. All these thoughts were running through my head, and a few bad competitions in a row, the thoughts just got worse and worse, and it then resulted in a loss of confidence. And, you know, I wasn't really sure how I was going to refine it and how I was going to get myself back up to the level that I was at before. And it's been a very slow process of chipping away at little things to slowly bring it back to this level now.
And what are those little things? What are the things that you do to start to rebuild that confidence that you had before?
Well, the first thing actually wasn't a little thing. The first one was a big change, and I moved from Leeds to Edinburgh. And I only did that because my old coaches basically told me to. They said that they were looking at me, and they'd been following my career since they had also left Leeds. And, you know, they talked me into making this change, which they thought would help me. And it really did. Just having like a fresh environment, a fresh set of eyes on me in terms of a coach, and just a new challenge, which made me step out of my comfort zone. And you know, it wasn't easy at the start, but actually, you know, being putting my back against the wall and having to fight and push, it helped me discover where my strengths lied and what I could actually do. And slowly I worked on the weaknesses of my dives, and, you know, the competition results slowly improved. And I worked on things outside of diving as well to help me become a better athlete and a better person. And, you know, things like joining up with the Dame Kelly Holmes Trust has really helped with that, because it's given me different perspectives on life, and actually realizing that life is bigger than just diving and life is bigger than just the Olympic Games helped me improve my confidence massively, because running up to 2016, all my thoughts were just on the Olympics. And I've had to change that in order to kind of rediscover my confidence.
Amazing. Well, thanks for sharing that. And Jenny, Yona mentioned there, he mentioned stepping outside his comfort zone. I know that's something I've heard you speak about plenty of times before. Why do you think it's so important to push ourselves outside of our comfort zones in order to sort of grow and build our self-belief and our confidence?
I think it's always meant a lot to me, I think, especially from retiring from badminton and being at that stage where I wasn't sure what I wanted to do next. And it was a big thing for me. I knew I wanted to help others in some capacity. And actually, for me, public speaking was something that I was massively fearful of. And that didn't matter whether I was speaking in front of 10 people, 50 people, or, you know, thousands of people. And actually, it's something that I've massively had to work on, to practice, to change the way that I think and feel in order to develop. And for me, that everyone always laughs at me. It's a quote that I love. You know, outside of your comfort zone is where the magic happens. And I've witnessed that firsthand in myself. You know, those feelings of not being in complete panic, being in that stretch zone when actually, yeah, I feel nervous and I've had to work hard to get to where I've been. But actually, whenever I have stretched myself, the feeling has just been fantastic afterwards. I've felt proud of myself. I've been excited. I've wanted to do it again. And actually, that's how I know that being in that stretch zone is such a good place to be, because it's motivated me to do more, to be more, to work on myself, to develop. And now I'm in a job that I absolutely love doing in different capacities. And I believe that's just from stepping out.
Yeah. And those people that haven't come across this type of language before, we often talk about where we learn best and where we develop and grow best. And we talk about three zones. We talk about comfort zone, a stretch zone, and panic zone. So when you're in your comfort zone, doing the things that you've always done day in, day out, nothing's changed, it becomes very easy and comfortable, but we don't learn much. Panic is the completely other end of the spectrum, where actually you push too far and you feel overwhelmed, you feel out of your depth. Quite often we have this fight, flight or freeze response. But in that zone that you both have spoken about really nicely, in our stretch zone, it does feel uncomfortable. You do feel nervous. It is new. You know, Yona talked about, you know, moving coaches, moving to a different part of the country, you know, big steps, speaking in front of people for the first time. So for people that are listening to this and wanting to sort of grow or build their confidence, what tips could you give them, Jen? What tips would you give them?
For me, one of the biggest things is always surrounding yourself with positive, like-minded people who want to push you, but also want the absolute best for you and are there sort of championing you every step of the way. I feel like I've got a very good support network, and I know I'm lucky in that respect. Not everyone does have that. But even if they don't, I think it's just that one person who believes in what you're capable of and is willing to support you and back you. And I think that's made a massive difference both in my badminton career and actually finishing when I've been through probably some of the most challenging times in my life, that actually I've had those people that have been very supportive and motivated me to improve myself, to work on how I feel. And that's just made a massive difference to my life in so many ways, really.
Yeah, that support networks. It's crucial. Yona, what about yourself? What tips could you give for people that wanted to sort of grow and develop a level of confidence?
Yeah, I totally agree with the surround yourself with other people that are similar minded. But to take it a step further than that, I think first you have to become more self-aware and realize the type of person that you are yourself. So then you know the type of people that you need to surround yourself with, because if you see yourself not as your true self, you might surround yourself with the wrong people and they might guide you down the wrong path. Whereas if you can see yourself openly and you know, believe the person that you are is the person that you want to be, then you can choose those people a little bit more easily and accurately. And from there, the confidence will just build so quickly, it'll probably blow your mind. So I think self-awareness is super, super important. And like, how do you achieve that? I think that's the next question. How do you achieve self-awareness? Like, what can you do? And there's various methods to do that in terms of getting advice from people that know you well, but also just taking that step back and analyzing what you've done and the journey that life's taken you on, and you know, some of the decisions that you've made along the way, and thinking about whether they're the right or wrong decisions or what you could have done differently. And I think that'll show you the type of person that you are, and then you can play to your strengths a little bit better, and that will, I think, in turn build confidence as you play to your strengths more and more.
Yeah, that's really good advice there, Yona. I think as well as sort of reflecting back on, you know, the journey that you've had or the experiences you might be having, but also sort of looking forward and thinking aspirationally, where do I want to get to, and what type of person do I want to be? Yeah. It is really, and sometimes when we're young, we don't know what our goals are, do we? We don't know where we want to end up. But I think it's important to start to develop and try new things, to try and figure all those things out, because when we're young, we are still, I guess, still learning, aren't we? And we don't know where we're going to end up.
Yeah, exactly. And you kind of just follow what people around you do, and that is a massive part of shaping your life. And you know, I was very fortunate to have really good people around me and people that pushed me in the right way, and I know that's not the case for everyone. So I guess it's easy for me to say that, you know, I found my confidence really easily because of all of that, but I know for others it's not as straightforward, but it takes real effort, and it's a real challenge to take that step away and really think about who you are as a person and what you need to further yourself as a person based on your strengths.
Fantastic. I'm going to put you both on the spot as a final question, or maybe penultimate question. But if we're talking about confidence, and it's about it can be very situational. So, you know, Yona, now you've talked earlier about being extremely confident with your diving. What situation could I put you in where you would not feel very confident?
I think a situation where I'm talking about something I don't really understand, or I've got to explain something I don't really understand. So, you know, as I say, I'm confident in my diving, I was going to say something like public speaking, but I'm actually quite comfortable with that when I'm talking about myself and my journey, because it's my story and I know it best and I can share it quite well. But as soon as you make me present some information I don't really know or I don't really understand, you know, if it's on like a particular subject, like when I had to do English presentations at school, it was a nightmare. And as soon as I've got to do something like that, my confidence is gone, because I don't know what my ability is with it. I don't trust in my ability with it. So yeah, I think that's where I feel the least confident, when I don't understand fully.
Great. Well, thanks for your honesty. And Jenny, same question. What situation could I put you into where you would feel underconfident?
I think for me, I love being prepared. I'm an over-preparer. So I think going to, you know, it's even been where we've had brilliant training days as athletes for the Dame Kelly Holmes Trust, to be able to go out and do the job we do. And I remember 8 years ago going to the first few and just being so unbelievably nervous, because I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't know anyone that we were meeting on the day, and actually to be in just a completely different environment that I'd never been in was quite nerve-wracking. And I guess what will be quite interesting for other people in that know me, you know, I always look like a very, you know, on a badminton court, there was no more confident. I always believed in myself. I always looked like, you know, it didn't matter whether I was playing the number one in the world or the number 100th in the world, I always believed that I could win. So I had a very, you know, confident persona, I guess, on a badminton court. I think when I'm taken away from that and I am unsure of what's about to happen and where I'm, what situation I'm about to be thrown in, that's when I'm in a more difficult position, for sure.
Great.
But I like that, it's a challenge.
Yeah, and I think what's come through from both of you, it's about preparation, isn't it? It's about pushing ourselves into those difficult spots where we do feel a little bit uncomfortable, but you know, guess what? When we're next in that position, it will feel slightly easier. It's like, you know, going to your first job interview or on your first date, isn't it? They're all like complete new things that can make people, you know, concerned, worried, anxious, whatever the feelings they might have. But actually, by the time your second interview or your third interview comes along, you feel far more prepared. But that's about being outside of your comfort zone and accepting that it's okay to feel uncomfortable.
But there's so many situations in life where you're actually unprepared for the circumstance, and you've just got to deal with it and handle it. And the more times you find yourself in that situation, you'll figure out different ways. And the first time you'll feel very low in confidence, but the next time, as you say, the confidence will build to be able to deal with it and improvise as quickly as possible and as best as possible.
And I think once you do that, that real sense of what, yes, I'm comfortable with what I've done now, and I'm just trying to do it better next time. And I think that's all, you know, we can ask of ourselves, but also of other people, to just try, give it a go.
Yeah, fantastic. Guys, thanks ever so much for your time. It's been super interesting listening to you both. There's some great tips in there about pushing ourselves outside our comfort zone, trying new things. It's okay to feel uncomfortable. All of that stuff hopefully really resonates with the people that are listening. But Yona, good luck for all your competitions coming later this year.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for your time today. And equally, Jenny, thanks ever so much for joining us. Really interesting to hear from you both. Bye for now.